All right. The gospel of our Lord. The good news of our Lord about a man who's dishonest. Right? The master who gets report that his money manager is squandering the books and making more money for himself than he should be, so he calls him. And this isn't like a formal charge here at the beginning. He just calls him in because his friends have told him that his manager is doing bad against him. So as I read this text for this week, and you can ask Carrie, she'll vouch for it for me. Because on Tuesday she normally asks me for a sermon title. I actually walked in the office before she asked for it, and I said, "You want a sermon title, don't you?" She said, "Yes, I'll need it at some point." And I said, "I got nothing for you." I read this text, my first thought is, really, Jesus? This is what you give us to work with? Really? This is the good news of Jesus. Be like a dishonest manager who makes money for himself, and when he finds out that he can't do that anymore, he shrewdly acts and go out and cuts what people owe his master. That's how we're supposed to act. That's what we're supposed to do. Really, Jesus? This is it? So I thought maybe I could preach on Amos, right? Did you read Amos? Is that any better? Talks about we'll make the epoch small and the shekel great. Did you realize that in Jesus' time that there were no standard weights and measures? So when you went from town to town and you were going to barter or you were going to trade stuff, you had to know what the weight was in that town and what the things were worth in that town because it was different for each town. There was no standard. So people in a town could cheat the system. You know, those who traded goods could easily cheat people out of stuff. And it's not unheard of for managers to charge an interest on things that people were borrowing from them, right? So, where do we go from there? Okay, we can talk about Timothy. Timothy's good, right? Timothy's about prayer. And yeah, we could talk about Timothy. And we could talk about, I could just pass out the instruments to everybody and we could just sit here all for 15 minutes and make noise and praise the Lord. But what does Jesus mean by this here? What is going on, and why do we have this text in the middle of all of this stuff? After the story of the lost things, right? Remember last week we talked about the things that are lost? The coin, the sheep, the younger son, and the older son. And how the younger son was shrewd and was spreading the wealth. And a manager who's charged with brought him, they were squandering, spreading the wealth. And this word here for squander doesn't necessarily mean that it's a bad thing. It means that he was scattering. It's the word that Jesus uses earlier when he talks about there was a man who went out and scattered seed, and some of it fell on the path, and some of it. The same word for squander is the same word for scatter. So maybe this guy is just investing his master's money. See, here's the good news this morning. I read this text, and I go, I don't get it. I don't understand it. Right? I don't understand it. All the things that I've studied, all the things I've done, I'm the one that's supposed to stand up here and tell you what all this stuff means, right? And I tell you this morning, I don't get it. I don't get it. So when you read your Bible and you go, I don't get it, you're in good company. All right? Because sometimes we just don't get what Jesus is talking about. But there's some stuff in here that we can definitely get. Right? This morning we're going to have a baptism. Piper Jennifer is going to come up here in just a little bit. And I'm going to pour water over the top of her head. I'm probably going to make her cry. But in that is the grace that God accepts her and names her, claims her as his own daughter, forgives her of everything she has done, of everything she's going to do when she comes to him and asks him to do that. And it's always going to be with her. Even when we mess up and drop her and not literally, of course. It does remind me of a story, though, but we'll have to go there. You know, because we let people down, right? In our lives and things that we do, we promise we're going to do things for people, and we let them down. Every one of us has done that, and if we can't say that we have done it, then come talk to me because I want to know how you do it. Never let anyone down before. Because we all do that. It's our humanness to look out for ourselves rather than for somebody else. And that's the way that we roll. But God is never going to do that for Piper. God is never going to do that for any one of us. right? And I told this story before, I know, and today I can actually get to my wallet. So I planned it that way. But when Roman soldiers were baptized, they were baptized like this, with their hand, right? They did full immersion baptisms in that day. And Roman soldiers would be baptized with their right hand up out of the water. And why did they be? Why were they baptized with their right hand up out of the water? Anyone?
Sword.
That's the hand that they wield their sword with, right? So I'm not giving everything over to God except for this, because I still have to be a loyal Roman centurion and do what the emperor tells me to, which means I'm going to have to kill people. So I can't have this be, well, does that actually work? And most of us want to get baptized like this. Right? God will give you everything there is, but you can't have this, right? And what's the very last verse today? A slave cannot serve two masters. You'll either despise the one and love the other, or love the one and hate the other. A man or a woman cannot serve wealth or God. Here's an interesting switch to think about. And most of us have probably never thought about this before, but most of us probably have, except for the wee little ones, and maybe some of the smart adults, have in your wallet something, right? You probably have in your wallet something that says this. Do you get it? Master. Master. Forget the card for a minute. Master. Right? I think MasterCard got it right when they decided what their name was going to be. Because truly, this can be the master of your world, right? This can be the thing that drives everything that we do. Which is what drove this manager to do what he did. He cooked the books so that he would have more money. And it wasn't necessarily a bad thing in that time and age to make somebody pay more than they owe. It's actually against the Jewish law, though, to charge interest. So if this man was a Jew, he knew that it was against the law when he was here. So Jesus tells us that we can't serve money and God. That we have to serve one or the other. And in that, there's also the underlying tint of, I can't serve the things that I have. I can't make them be idols or gods for me either, right? I have to serve God. I have to put God first.
So we have to serve God in the things that we do. Okay, I get that.
I can handle that. Okay, so then Jesus, tell me about this verse right here, verse 9. It says, and I tell you, make friends for yourself by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it's gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. I'm supposed to use money I got dishonestly to make friends with people so that I'll have some place to be in all of eternity. Does anybody else have a problem with that? What? It's a Robin Hood, thank you. It's a Robin Hood method, right? It's Robin. Did you read my blog?
No.
Okay. It's actually what I said in my blog. So, but it is. It really is. It's about what Robin Hood did, right? Robin Hood was a person who stole from the rich and gave it to the poor. Actually, he took back from the king what he had taken from the poor. So therefore, what he was doing was right. He was still stealing, right? And actually, stealing is one of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not steal is one of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not lie is not one of the Ten Commandments. It is in the Bible, though. Leviticus 19, verse 20. Don't hold me to that. Leviticus chapter 19, I know. So, don't steal. Robin Hood was taking what the king had already taken from these poor people and in return, turning it back over to them, giving it back to them. But it still isn't right. So what does Jesus mean by this dishonest wealth, right? We want to talk about reading things and understanding them, taking things literally. Is everything in this book supposed to be taken literally, word for word? This might shock some people here. Patrick's going to say, no! You're not supposed to take everything out of this book 100% literally word for word. Some of it is an allegory. Some of it is simile. Some of it is teachings to help us understand stuff. And again, I think this is actually where Jesus is turning things over on its head as he normally does, the things that he says. Make friends with dishonest wealth, so that you might have a place in an eternal home. Where does the money that you have come from? Do you get it all honestly? I'm not asking you to confess anything. Please don't. Right? But even if you got it honestly, if you got it from work, you got it from savings, you got it from investing, where did it ultimately come from?
God.
Not from us, not from anything I've done. There's no such thing as a self-made man. Period. God is working in and through everything that has happened. And God gives us everything that we have. And God calls us to be a good steward. Now, some of these people in this day and age did get things dishonestly because they charged interest, and they charged more than they should have for interest. And tax collectors charged a surcharge over and above what they collected for their taxes. All of that money is dishonest wealth. And when Jesus says here, this is my interpretation now, when Jesus says here to make friends with by using dishonest wealth and spreading it around, it's you giving to those who are in need. How many of us know someone in need? You know, the United Way just did a study, and they just released it. If you haven't seen it, look it up. It's called ALICE. A-L-I-C-E. Don't ask me what ALICE stands for. It's an acronym for something, but I don't remember off the top of my head right now. But it showed that 42% of the families living in the state of Wisconsin do not have enough money to pay for basic needs. 42%. I heard it another way last Thursday that I couldn't find documentation for, but I believe that it's probably true, and it's close to the 42% number in my head. It would be 40%. But 2 out of 5 families, right? Because 40% is 2 out of 5. 2 out of 5 families don't have enough money to meet basic needs in the state of Wisconsin. 2 out of 5 families. How many families do we have this week? Ushers, how many people are here? Around the lobby. Okay, 170. There's 5 to a family, which there's not. That's what? Real quick, math. 30. 35. 35 families we have here. So that means?
14.
Thank you, whoever said that. I'm usually really good with numbers, but I'm in front of a bunch of people and y'all make me nervous, so I can't talk in front of people. 14 families here this morning don't have enough money to meet the basic needs. If we pay the statistics the way that they send you. Right? So use the money that you've got, however you've got it, to help those families. And in doing that, you're not going to gain an eternal home from them. Who are you gaining your eternal home from? The person that we're called to follow. The person that we're called to serve. You see, it's all about serving God. Because even Luke reads this, heard this story and wrote it down for us to have, and then he still fumbles with it afterwards, right? Because he throws in these three statements, 10, 11, 12. Whoever is faithful with very little will be faithful in much. Whoever is dishonest in very little will be dishonest in much. If you have been faithful with dishonest wealth, then you'll be trusted with true riches. If you can use now what God has given you, no matter how you came into possession of it, God is going to see that and see that you are actually following Him and doing what He's called you to. And if you have not been faithful, you're not going to be faithful with anything else.
So what this all boils down to this morning is us following after God.
And living our lives in the small things that happen. It's not about us doing something big for somebody else. It's about us doing the small things day in, day out. Right? None of us this week are probably going to finish a novel, write a book, christen a ship, have dinner with the president, or a presidential candidate. That's the most you'll ever hear talk about politics. None of us are going to do that. But all of us might have the opportunity to walk the neighbor's dog, or feed the neighbor's cat, or get the mail for somebody, or offer somebody who's working a glass of water or a bottle of water. We all have that little thing that we can do. So as you came in this morning, This is all truly about relationships and how we live and what we're doing in the world. You were given a green card. It doesn't mean that you get access to in here or get out of this. It has nothing to do with the green card, right? But it is just happens to be green. I should. There you go. More political talk. But you have a green card. On this green card, if you choose to do this, I want you to write. Listen all the way through this before you start to write. I want you to write the name of a person who you want to invest your time in over the next 30 days. Because it's all about how we live in our lives on a day in and day out basis and how we can be Christ to somebody in our world. There's probably somebody out there that we've let down. There's somebody out there that we've let go. There's somebody out there that needs our attention. Who is it? I want you to write their name on this piece of paper. I want you to fold it in half. And then I want you to write the date 10/18/16 on it. You can get your piece of tape if you want. I want you to take it home and put it someplace where you're going to remember where it is. And then on 10/18, I want you to open it up and look at the name you wrote here. And think about it. I'm not going to ask you on the 16th or the 23rd of October if you did this or not. There's no judgment. There's no follow-up. There's no nothing. This is between you and God. Write a name on this piece of paper of a person that you want to invest in time in. Your time, your possessions, everything that you can. Because that's why God gave us the things that He gave us. So that we could give them to somebody else. So that He could give us more. So that we could give that to somebody else. Because God calls us to follow Him. And by following Him, we're investing in the lives of others. So how can we do that? So write the name of your person, fold the piece of paper in half, and write 10/18/16 on it. And put it someplace where you'll see it on 10/18/16. Like I said, there's no reminders between you and God. Because that's where God wants us to be. Doing the small things for the people that are going to take time.